Journey with Judy.
Honest, open, transparent. It's hot.
There's no such thing as perfect people. There's no such thing as a perfect life. So come as you are, broken and scarred. Lift up your heart and be amazed and be changed by a perfect God.
Okay, so someone the other day when I asked them how they were, their response was, I'm blessed beyond anything I could ask, imagine, or dream of. And that is where I'm coming from this morning. I am definitely those things. But I do miss being with you. Last week, you had a best of show because I had the privilege of being with my family on a family vacation in Cancun. And I can tell you that we went there, broken and scarred, as the intro song states. We have not been on a family vacation to 4 years. Bobby and I have been really diligent about taking our time away. We ran out of money about 4 years ago to take everybody, so we, of course, still went. You know that story, like, pack your bags, where are we going? We're going nowhere, you're leaving. Well, Bob and I would be really good about having our trips once a year at least, but it had been that long since we got together as a family and journeyed in any capacity, without any distractions, to a place long enough to really see the good again. And I kept saying, like, we got to get back to the basics. We got to remember why God made us a family. Things have been really tough at my house, and I'm not sure if it's because my kid's going to college or my other kid's graduating from eighth grade. I don't know, but it's just been really tough. Things like this were said the week before we went. My son emailed me, my son Carter, who's a senior in high school. He said, I'm not going. I don't want to be with the family. You don't want me there. I'm not going. Kennedy and Campbell both asked if Bob and I had to go, why it was necessary that we attend. Okay, so the reality is, just so you, in case you guys know, a family vacation requires the family and not just the people that you like in your family. That's what made all the trips Bob and I have ever done together wonderful. But here's the deal. Because Bob and I spend every day together, basically, we really don't have never experienced that, oh, we need to get away and do that whole reconnecting thing. You know what I mean, Dave? Like how couples go and they have to be reconnected and they come home refreshed and renewed in their love and their marriage. Well, Bob and I have never experienced that. Now, let me clarify. Not that we have not been renewed, but we've never felt that disconnection, I guess, at least not in the last, you know, however many years. So I was never like this big believer, really, in the fact that you go away and those things happen. Well, I am here to tell you that that's exactly what happened on our family vacation at Cancun. Now, keep in mind, we had been there as a family 10 times. We used to go twice a year for a number of years. And the last couple times we went, we had really great experiences like Hurricane Katrina. We were the family that went the day after the swine flu was determined to be originating there in Mexico. And people would say, you're seriously going to put your children in danger? And my response would be, you driving your kids around drunk is just as much being in danger as me taking them to Mexico. Anyway, another time Campbell had an asthma attack and she almost died. Seriously. So why we were venturing back into Cancun, because I guess we are insane. Insanity, by definition, is doing the same thing over and over and expecting a different result. So the deal was, is we made a lot of promises. Like, I made so many promises. First and foremost, if you listen to previous shows, you would know that the last time I went on the most perfect vacation where every one of my needs was anticipated, expected, and met beyond my dreams, I was totally discontent. You remember that, Dave? I complained about everything. So I had this really big promise that I was going to approach this with an attitude of gratitude, therefore making love the primary part of every equation. So that was my goal. My daughter Campbell, she was so excited to attend. She just kept saying, like, doing the countdown, like, 7 more days, 6 more days. And she kept saying, Mom, promise. Promise you're going to do this with me. Promise you're not going to do that. Promise you won't be crabby and tired and complain about everything. So anyway, here's the deal. As God would have it, we encountered a couple early on in the trip that sat down and started talking to us about their children, who are a little bit older than my kids now. And that always gives me hope that people are still married and their kids are still talking to them after all these years, because I wonder how this whole thing will play out.
Well, the exciting thing was they had the same values as Bob and I. And few and far between do we find couples who are trying to control their children as much as we are, good, bad, or indifferent. It's just the way we roll. And so this couple was absolutely amazing. But there was one clear difference between this couple and our family. And here's what clearly defined the difference. We had asked them if it was their first time there, and they said, yes, it was. And I said, oh, my gosh, we've been here like 10 times, and how do you like it? And they said, you know, it's phenomenal. But we had to switch rooms. And I said, really? So did we. And they said, well, we had to switch rooms because our toilet overflowed, our shower didn't work, we had no hot water, and our safe was broken. And she said, I kept telling my husband, like, we really need to call and switch rooms. And he was like, well, let's not make a big deal of it. And my response to them was, we needed to switch rooms too, but that wasn't at all the reason. When we get back, I'll tell you what the reason was. You are listening to Journey with Judy right here on Lake Nick. Where is it? Lake 96.1. That is correct. Morning, because I'm back with you hosting Journey with Judy after being gone on a family vacation that was more needed than I ever thought possible. And here's the deal. Like this couple that we met who had so many similarities in their faith and their parenting, and it seemed like as a couple, a lot of the same values that Bob and I have. Well, when we got down to talking about the resort itself and the accommodations and how they liked it, they made it perfectly clear that they had to change rooms because they had no hot water, the shower didn't work, the toilet overflowed, and the safe was broke. And so I looked at Carter, I looked at them, and I said, we had to change rooms too, but not for that reason. We had to change rooms because we didn't like the view. Okay, now here's the deal. You have to understand, we were in a 2,500 square foot room with a master suite, a living room and a dining room, four beds for the kids to sleep in. Now, I'm not saying that to be bragging on you. I'm saying that because the reality was we, meaning me, myself, and I, found fault with something that was promised to us before we got there that they didn't deliver on. So that whole thing about, but you promised. Now, let's back up a little. I promised too. I promised to have a great attitude, to not complain, to focus on the positive, to be mindful of the moment, and to celebrate every bit of intensity and diversity amongst every one of my kids. I pinky sweared Campbell a million times. I crossed my heart and hoped to die, to stick a needle in my eye that this was going to be the best trip ever, just because we were going to be present to one another. Okay, so it lasted 32 seconds until I walked into the Moon Palace, and then I complained because I didn't get the room I wanted. Now, keep in mind, I am the self-righteous person who would always ask for a manager. In the olden days before I was a Christian, Dave, I would walk in a store and I'd ask for the manager because something was always not to my satisfaction. And when my son got old enough to say and to notice that about my disposition, we would walk in a store and he would go, Mom, why don't you just try to ask for the manager right now? Because I always felt so entitled and so presumptuous. And the bottom line was, that was the difference in this couple and me. And my family just follows suit, of course. So the reality was we shared so many things in common, but they adjusted to the situation and I didn't. I was so set on the fact that I was promised something. And that's what we're talking about today. We're talking about the fact that we commit, we pledge, and we promise. You remember when you were a kid, you would really pinky swear, you would really cross your heart and hope to die. And you know what? It meant something. But somewhere our definition of a promise, which is just an assurance and a declaration that one is going to do something that they say, and it's a guarantee that something is going to happen. Somehow, in the course of our lives, we've come to accept the fact that promises, they're just made to be broken. See, we can say to you, promise now, but it really doesn't mean it's a guarantee. It used to be, but now it's not enough. See, instead of pinky swear, we say sign here. Instead of do you promise to, we say, I want that in writing. See, we got older, we got wiser. And as a result of that, we become less trusting in a person and their promises. See, we want a guarantee, don't we, Dave? How often do you look at something? Every product comes with a money-back guarantee. Would you buy it if it had a money-back guarantee? I can't tell you how many things I return. I return things like one time I returned sheets that were like 6 years old and a mattress that was like 4 years old. Because they promised it would last longer. I don't remember why. Because I was self-righteous, more self-righteous and entitled then than I am now that I'm a Christian. The other thing I used to do is park in a handicapped spot. And my brother said, well, now that you're a Christian, would you be not, and just so you know, I'm not handicapped. So anyway, the fact, back to the, I'm so fired up to be back with you today. And I'm sorry about that. So let's channel my energy positively and talk about pinky promises.
No, the parking.
Oh, the parking.
Brother,
oh, yeah. Oh, so my brother used to say to me, like, well, now that you're a Christian, are you still going to park in a handicapped spot?
And your answer?
And my answer, I can't. Like, what? You know what? Here's the thing. When I was correcting this manager about the fact that he promised all these things at the hotel, I made three of my children remove themselves from my presence because I did not want them to see their self-righteous, entitled mother asking for something that was promised and not delivered. Yet I did want Carter to be there to understand the proper negotiating skills. Anyway, long story short, we buy things that have a money-back guarantee because it allows us to go back and say, hey, wait a minute, you promised. The other thing that it does is it guarantees that there's really no risk. See, when people make promises, that's assuring someone that one is definitely going to do or give something that they promised. So when we get a money-back guarantee, we can call people out on that and hold them accountable. But here's the gig is we're really not surprised when in our relationships, whether personally or professionally, when the promises aren't kept. See, promises are like invisible currency in a relationship. It defines it. It defines its quality and its nature. Like, if you promise me something and you deliver, it's making a million deposits in our relationship. But if you promise something and you don't, it's just like one great big withdrawal at one time. I can't tell you how many times I stand in front of other people, whether they're talking about their kid, their relationship with their kid, their boss, their spouse. They said, they promised, and they didn't deliver. And I think it would be true to say that the more significant the relationship, the more extensive the expectation of the promises are. See, when I said better or worse, I didn't realize that those vows should be written to better and worser and, oh my gosh, to the point of death almost at some in some cases. And then there's something about the people in your life that you judge to be a promise keeper or a promise breaker, right, Dave? Like, I know that I probably can't ask certain people to do anything because I know if they promise to say do or be it, they're not capable. One of the rules we had on our family trip was no electronics. I want you to imagine that. Six hairs, no stimulation. Now, we probably don't need the stimulation, but the fact of the matter is my kids always have something that is a distraction to them. And all I wanted was to be in their presence. So they all promised. We promise no phones. Now, I really didn't think they'd be capable of keeping that promise, which is why Bob made them watch them, put them on the counter in the kitchen counter before we pulled away.
Oh, they didn't take them with.
No, they didn't take them with.
Oh.
And so that was real. Wasn't that a big deal to have no phone? I mean, not even on the way, because they're like, well, what about on the way to the airport or what are we going to do in between flights? You're going to chat. You're going to be present to your mom and dad, which really they weren't looking forward to. But here's the gig. Kennedy is the only one who violated our no electronic program because Kennedy had her iPod at the pool. I caught her at the pool texting off of her iPod. But see, I served up the mercy because even though Kennedy made the same promise that Carter and Chandler did, with Ken, I knew that it was like so much for her to even consider not having communication electronically. Whereas the boys, it was a different expectation based on the fact that they kept other promises. See, performance is related to what we perceive and how we judge our relationship and what they promised. So what I expect of you is based on our past promises. One's ability to come through on their promise doesn't only affect the nature and the quality of the relationship, but it matters to the degree about how you engage with them in the future. Whether it was a kept promise or a broken promise. I believe that we move in the direction of the promises made to us. Regardless of if it was about trust or love or a cell phone or protection. It doesn't matter. It all goes under this great big umbrella, and we travel down the road of life moving in the direction of the promises either made to us and kept or unkept. See, I can trace back and see promises in my past that have totally affected me today. So a past broken promise doesn't only affect the right now, but it affects the future. Promises made to us, by us. They're like a deal maker, but they're also a deal breaker. When someone does or doesn't keep their promise, or doesn't keep their pinky swear, it affects so many aspects of our life. See, because I totally hate when someone doesn't keep their word. And there's somebody else who even hates it more. Let's talk about that when we get back. You are listening to Journey with Judy right here on Lake 96.1. And thank you to the Cunis Country Auto Group for making this show possible. We'll be back. And hold on. Right, so we're holding on to the promises, I hope. We left for the break saying that not only do you hate when someone doesn't keep their word, but God hates it even more. That's our verse today. The Lord hates those who don't keep their word, but delights in those who do. And let's be honest. God doesn't hate anything. He hates the sin, but loves the sinner. So not only you, but him. He hates it even more. You know why? Because what we believe about promises from people translates into our faith life. It's based on how we perceive him as someone who can't keep their promises either. He doesn't want any more broken promises because it affects our faith. And growing in our faith is not about making more promises to God. See, we believe that. When the reality is, it's about believing more in the promises of God. Because we act on what we remember most. In our past relationships with deal makers and deal breakers and promise keepers and promise breakers, it's the same with our faith. What are we remembering about the promises made by God? Because they're so not like somebody else's. When my son sent me that email before my trip and said, "I'm not going," I called my spiritual companion and she immediately responded by saying, "God told me. God told me and he promised that not only will Carter go, but it will be the best trip ever." And see, that's a promise that I held on to. And he delivered. Because now that we're back from vacation and back to reality and everything's falling apart again, I know that God is faithful to complete the work that he's begun because that's his promise. Like the song says, hold on to the promises. What are they? Here's what they are. If God is for you, who can be against you? He is faithful to complete the work that he's begun because all things are possible. Like, I never would have thought it was possible for us to reconnect, for us to recommit in a 7-day period to enjoy the presence of one another's presence. That was the present. We played together. We ate together. We laughed together. We even worshiped together. I got a lot of grief about going to church on vacation, but I'll say we went. They lived without their phones for 1 week. I promised them they would, and the promise I delivered. See, this thing about a promise, it's the only thing you can give and keep at the same time. One of the biggest promises they kept is at the end of the trip, they all told me
They kept blowing me off. I kept saying to them, I want to know before we leave from each of you, your hope, your dream, your fear, your fault, and your failure. I'll save that whole concept for another show because that's a whole show in and of itself. But they kept blowing me off, and they said, I promise, before we leave Mexico, I'll give you that information. And they did. And it was just one more gift. So we got to keep our promises. When we don't keep our promises, we trust that God is faithful to do so. And remember, his promises aren't like anybody else's. Because when he declares and assures that he will do a particular thing, and he guarantees that it's going to happen, he definitely will. And you can count on it. Thanks for listening to Journey with Judy this morning. We'll be back to wrap it up. You are listening to Lake 96.1. Okay, so before we end today's show, I'm going to make you one more promise. I promise you that I am going to be at the Women's Resource Fair this Saturday, March 2nd at 2 p.m., and I will be presenting the topic of loving the skin I'm in. The location is Geneva Ridge Resort on Highway 50 in Lake Geneva. It's a two-day show with over 50 booths and seminars on health, wellness, nutrition, exercise, and weight loss. And come on, you got to come. There's free chair massages throughout the 2 days and goodie bags. Dave, you can even come, even though it's a women's resource fair. Goodie bags for the first 50 people each day. www.womensresourcefair.org if you want to get more information about that. And how about this? Pamper yourself at the spa night Friday, March 1st from 5 to 7. So come listen to me talk about loving the skin I'm in. I would love to meet you and know that someone listens to this show besides my family. Oh, they don't even listen. I'm lying. My husband, he's the only one who has to listen. So here's the deal. This week, hold on to the promises. Stop whining and complaining and start believing and receiving that with God, all things are possible. Because even the hairs kept some of their pinky swears. This week, keep it hot, honest, open, and transparent. My man Dave and Nancy are next with Life Matters. Keep it hot. Honest, open, and transparent. Peace out!